and welcome to Hacking the Exile, the in-depth program that takes a closer look at the webisode Exile 6e. Today, at the premiere episode, we have the star of the show, Amelia Andersdotter, here. Welcome.
Thank you.
So tell us about Exile 6e, and let's start with the name.
Well, Exile 6e was named after the location of our office in the European Parliament, because we were placed in an office located very far away from the rest of our political groups. We arrived 2.5 years late, and there was some logistical difficulties, I guess, in the Parliament, placing us close to, say, our other pirate colleague, Christian Engström, and also closely together with the other Greens. So we are in the E building on the 6th floor, whereas the rest of the Green group will be at the 8th floor of the G building. And it's our exile. We are in exile from the rest of the political group on the 6th floor in the E building, Exile 16.
Has anyone ever gotten this joke, except people working here?
No.
Well, now it is on a t-shirt, and that should probably help a little bit with people remembering the name.
We hope so. And also, we have a lot of fun in Exile 6e, so it's a place that deserves great recognition.
Yeah. And also the posters that we have put up outside the Exile, making it a little bit more colorful. Tell me about those.
Well, posters is something that you get when you organize events in the Parliament, or that you can get when you organize an event in the Parliament. An event would be specific time when you have a reason to communicate something with your other colleagues or discuss a particular issue that you might be working on at the time. So we try to organize our events in office, which means we do most, like, we set up a panel that we think will lead to an interesting debate on a current political issue, and then we make posters so that the events get advertised, and we invite people, often also from outside of the Parliament, to come and participate and see what is being discussed in the House. I think we have like 6 posters now.
Something like that.
But we're working on getting more. And to our great joy, also some of our colleagues in the corridor are also putting up their own posters. So we have now even more color when we come to the Excel every day.
It was a bit gray when we started.
Yeah.
But these posters also sometimes get into episodes of the webisode, like the Bloggers for Democracy event. It's not only a poster on the wall, it's also a full episode from last year.
Yeah, so I think that we've made 2 special webisodes in Exile 6e about events that we organized. Also, when we talked about public sector information, that entire process of collecting people from the entrance, like how do you get them entrance badges and how do you ensure that the speakers know where they need to sit and if they need a laptop for a presentation, how do you connect it to the right plugs. I think all of that was covered in one webisode.
So is it safe to say that the show is more about the everyday life of working in the Parliament rather than the big picture political aspects?
Well, the idea of the Exile 6e webisode series was to make it into kind of an informative docu-soap about what it is like to try and make it together in the European Parliament when, yeah, under unexpected circumstances, and how do you get an office up and running and functioning, and also, like, what are the type of characters that you would expect to find in the European Parliament? Because I think a lot of people think about this place not as necessarily human. But I think that we are actually having a lot of fun and sometimes also agonizing moments. But
and if we look back at the 1.5 year the show has been running, do you have any favorite episodes so far?
So actually, I like the last webisode that was from Strasbourg, a normal day in Strasbourg, when we had our 2 interns, Valerie and Felipe, and me getting by in Strasbourg with the, like, how do you get the eating, what does the Strasbourg buildings look like, what are the meetings like, and how do you deal with the dynamics that occur in meetings also. It was a...
So if you haven't seen that episode, make sure to watch it on YouTube. But for the coming episodes, the theme of this year seemed to be data protection. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Well, the data protection regulation was a political proposal launched by the Commission in January of 2012. and it's an upgrade of the old data protection framework in the European Union, which was a directive from 1995. It's implemented in all of the member states, of course, but in my member state, Sweden, it's implemented in the form of personuppgiftslagen from 1997. So what we found with having this in a directive form was that it's actually often very difficult to enforce the rights that we are granted through this legislation. And they're very important. They're constitutionally protected in most member states. And we also have the European Convention of Human Rights that grants us the right to privacy and to our own identities and the ability to form our own identities. So this is a very important right that the European states have consolidated in between themselves, and in the form of a regulation as proposed last year, we would have better tools to make all citizens able to use that rights and actually like feel that they have those rights. But it's also been very controversial. So when you make a big rehaul of a directive, which is kind of a general directive, because this is this will be a regulation that sets down general principles for the European Union on data protection. It doesn't specifically regulate any particular industry, and it doesn't specifically regulate any particular citizen's relationship with any particular other actor. So there was kind of like a 6 month period, I think, when everyone was just very, very busy trying to understand what this regulation would mean for them. And then sometime in September or October last year, the lobbies came down on the parliament. Now we have a draft report in the committee in the parliament, which is primarily responsible for the issue, which isn't technically too bad. There are some places where I could believe that they've been a bit cautious about what they're requesting, but it's not catastrophic. And then we have opinion-giving committees in the parliament where it really is like the industry interests have really cracked down on this regulation, because everyone appears to be perceiving it as a regulatory framework specifically aimed at them, and also because data protection law has been very fragmented in the past between the member states. People have difficulties, I think, assessing how it will affect them. And it's very easy to scare people with stuff that isn't true, which is also a lot what has been happening. So we've had some industries have tried to make the personal data of citizens or the identities of citizens into their intellectual property, for instance. And this, clearly, when you think about it, it isn't really reasonable, but the way that they would argue is that unless it is our intellectual property, then the citizens will commit fraud. And for a member of the European Parliament who isn't very initiated in this debate, you wouldn't normally want to be responsible for a legal framework that facilitates fraud, because fraud is something bad that we want to get rid of. So things like that.
Okay, and we shouldn't talk about winning and losing in the parliament, because we're all making legislation together, but are we winning or losing this regulation?
Currently, it's looking very, very bad. And I think on Monday, there were reports from, like, the American industries have in particular been extremely aggressive, and they also have the backing of the American government in this. So in Germany, in Berlin, on Monday, we had one ambassador insinuating that we might have a trade war over this regulation, which is actually very, very stupid, because we've had these laws already mostly for 20 years. The data protection regulation is actually not that innovative as a legislative instrument. It doesn't overhaul or create a revolution in any way in terms of like legislation or the rights that we have. What it does do is make them more easily enforceable, and that is for the benefit of everyone, because we have these rights for a reason.
Clearly, anyone who've watched this long into this show has endurance. If they want to use that endurance to help with making the legislation better, how should they do that?
Right now, I think that it would be very good if citizens could contact their deputies in the European Parliament and tell them that this is something that is of concern to them. So if you think that it's important that your private data is kept in a safe way, or that your personal data gets protection, but that your personal data can't be just removed from you for whatever reason and then put into the legal rights of some other entity, or even if you believe that, for instance, government agencies should not be able to acquire your data in whatever way, because we know from the past that if there is a database, then normally the government will find a way to get access to it. So it could be good for us to actually ensure that there aren't too many databases around, or that the databases that are around are adequate and proportionate to their purpose. So just write to your deputies and tell them that this is how you feel, because we are in an extremely heavy storm of information around the data protection regulation, and citizen voices are gravely underrepresented in that storm of opinions.
So write to your MEPs, and Swedish viewers can also go to dataskydd.net to get more information on how to make a difference on this. But to the final topic of today, in the webisode there is always Creative Commons music, but in our office it's mainly when you need the energy from music, it's Italo disco, or at least for a long time that was the main music category being played. Why Italo disco?
Well, so when I was in my teens, I actually listened to a lot of post-punk. But then I ended up in an IRC channel on FNET, I think, sometime in the past. And this very kind gentleman that I met transmitted to me a song by Laserdance called Power Run, and I thought that was very awesome. This was like 8 years ago or so, and I still wasn't able to detach from Italo disco. I still get happy from it. There's also going to be a party in Stockholm on the 24th or the 25th of May, where Italo disco will be played. And my project for later this year is to have Zix Records release their Italo disco catalogs from the 1980s on the Creative Commons, because I think that would be a boon to the world if we could get an Italo renaissance from easily sampleable, happy music that energizes people and motivates them for the future.
We're all hoping for that. And if you're producing Italo disco under Creative Commons, feel free to send it to amelia.andersdotter@ep.europa.eu. You can probably find that email address somewhere more convenient. With the music, and if it's under Creative Commons, it might actually show up in the webisode. With that, I'm thanking for this first proper episode of Hacking the Exile. We will be back in 2 weeks, and then you will meet Tess, who is the producer of the show. She will talk about the creation of the program. Thank you for watching, and thank you for coming.
Thank you for having me.